each other and listen to each other and play games with each other and love each other, and we had to do it face to face. In short, whether we realized it or not at the time, we were blessed that night to connect and affirm that most precious part of who we are. That part that, like missing the forest for the trees, we so very, very often gaze right past. That part of us which is the living spirit of God. Sometimes, admittedly, it's hard to see. We do such a good job of hiding our divine self with our temper and frustrations, our professional veneer and the like. I'm reminded of a scene from the Spielberg version of Peter Pan with Robin Williams. And how Williams, as Peter, now grown, returns to Never Never Land in search of his children who have been kidnapped by Captain Hook. Along the way, he is reunited with the lost boys. But the years of corporate worry and adult responsibility had taken their toll on Peter. His childhood self was lost under layer upon layer of distraction. The lost boys, his one-time companions, don't recognize him at all until at one point, one of the youngest of the boys, curious, comes close. Peter's already hunched down low, and the little boy looks closely into his eyes for some time. Then using his hands, he begins to move Peter's face, pushing his cheeks this way and that, looking for someone he once knew. And then the smile and the soft voice of recognition. Oh, there you are, Peter. I almost didn't see you in there. It's easy to miss the divine spirit in one another, unless at times we look very carefully. In fact, it's easy to dismiss the whole notion as a homiletical contrivance. Only it isn't a contrivance at all. There is such a thing as God, and God does exist in each of us. Ask any young parent what their favorite time of the day is, and they'll tell you most assuredly, bedtime. Two of the most magical words in a parent's lexicon. Bedtime, once they're down, means peace, quiet, adult time. And yet there's an even better time than this. And whether your children are young or are now old, you'll certainly agree. It comes right before turning in ourselves, when we go to make sure that our kids are tucked in tight, when we go to place a kiss on their cheek, and we stop for a moment, struck by their beauty. There in the softened light as they lay asleep, though they may have been the most devilish terror but only a few short hours ago, lies such innocent perfection that we can only stand and marvel. There is the child who once slept in our arms, who laughed at our silly sounds, who made us feel like we were the greatest thing on earth. In that moment of quiet, that holiness, when the day and the world fall away before all that truly matters, we know that the angel in front of us is heaven sent. There upon his smile, around her eyes, across his brow, there accentuated by every soft, quiet breath, there in the promise of dreams, there rests the Spirit of God. The image, the Spirit of God. It is perhaps the greatest gift God could have ever bestowed on humanity. It's the prime motivation for every good thing we are capable of. Imagine if a moment ago, after we had read the Torah, I had picked it up, held it high. Imagine, God forfend, instead of rolling it, I sent it crashing into the ground. How would you react? Some, no doubt, would faint. Some, frozen with shock. Others, I hope, would rush to pick it up. But we would react as we would because the Torah is a holy book. And more than that, it is the Word of God, and therefore, it represents everything we hold to be sacred and true. In a million years, we would rather suffer any number of indignities rather than see the Torah treated in such a way. The Torah is special, it's sacred, it's holy, it demands special treatment. So do we. Imagine if this is the way we treat the Word of God, how much more should we treat the very Spirit of God? Much too often we lose sight of this cardinal principle. Instead of seeing God's Spirit across from us, we see the means to an end. We see titles and roles, not the people who fill them. When we do not recognize the breath of God in one another, we do not treat each other as we should. We let each other fall to the ground and remain there upon the floor. Rabbi Harold Kushner tells a short story he remembers reading in high school. In the story, there was a scene in which the wife of a British colonel stationed in India had been expecting company for tea one afternoon. By noon, she looked up and was horrified to see that her gardener had not shown up for work that morning, and that the front walk was covered with leaves and dirt. When the gardener finally arrived around 1 o'clock, she tore right into him, screaming how unappreciative he was to have such a good job and how easily she could replace him. When she had finished her tirade, the man looked up at her and quietly apologized, sharing how his little girl had died in the night and how he had to take the morning to attend to her burial. For the first time, instructs Rabbi Kushner, the colonel's wife had to see this man not just as someone who was useful to her, someone who showed up to sweep the steps every morning, but as a human being, with family, with pains, with problems of his own. How much more would she have gained? How much healing might he have found if first she had seen the Spirit of God rather than a gardener? This season tells us that although we cannot control what others might say or do, we can control how we respond. And if from this day on our response to others is shaped in deference to the image of God before us, in time that same perception will manifest itself in those with whom we interact. Mitzvah v'eretz mitzvah. People treated as the image of God learn to treat others in the same way.